Hello, good morning. So today's presentation, we are going to see the petroleum production engineering artificial lifting technology. So in the upstream sector of the petroleum engineering, there are a lot of equipments are utilized in enhancing your oil from your well. So, like sucker rod pumping, beam pumping units, gas lift, ESPs, electrical submersible pumps, and other processes. So, in this presentation, we will see the overview of artificial lifting technology in petroleum engineering. Let's go to the presentation. So artificial lifting technology, serial number one, part one of artificial technology one. In artificial technology two, we will see more on the design and of the individual equipments. So now let's go. So what is this short course contents? So you have the first introduction, flowing wells, artificial lifting methods, oil treating, storage and sale of your produced oil from your well, then salt water disposal and other gas treatment methods. So the production technology is one of the important stage of your oil well. Once the oil and gas are produced from your well. So all these different types of oil rigs, whether it's onshore or offshore, they used to drill and complete the well. And the next stage is after the drilling, so you have to go for the next production. Once they close the wellbore and they started getting this collection from their Christmas tree or production trees. So this valve, what you are seeing in the Christmas tree, regulates pressures, control flows, and allows to assist the wellbore for the further completion works are if needed. And from the outlet of the valve of the production tree, so the flow can be connected to number of networks or distribution network of pipelines and tanks to supply the product to the refineries, natural gas compressor stations, or you can export or to the export terminals. So this is the schematic of your production of crude oil from the reservoir. So wellbore, so wellhead, this is your Christmas tree. From there, it's go to separator, and you are separating oil, gas, and water. So Christmas tree, you will see in the design the our artificial technology too. So next slide. So this is the process overview of your production of crude oil from your well. So you can see here the production wellheads are numbered 1, 2, 3, 4 like that, and production and test manifolds are connected, and gas compressors, then metering and storage and export. So oil and gas metering is a separate topic, and then production separators are available. First stage separator, second stage separator. Then we are doing the water treatment, disposal, etc. Then we have the injection wells, injection manifolds also there. So this is the overview of your oil and gas production process. So you can see detail in the next slides. So all this oil and gas process, the process equipments, take the products from the wellhead manifolds and get delivered in the form of crude oil or condensate or gas. So the components of the process also exist in downstream. So once you are getting your products, so you are sending this to the refineries to get produced diesel, kerosene and other lubricant oils. So you can see here the simplified process flow diagram of your oil and gas process system. So from the production inlet, it goes to separator, then get heated, then again sent for water knockout, water knockout unit where water outlet is there, and gas is also separated, and again it goes to the thermal treatment. Then it's go to heated, then dehydrators, first stage desalter, second stage desalts also there for the removal of the salts. And this is the oil and gas process flow diagram, simplified form. So now flowing wells, once you started drilling, once the drilling has completed, so there's a well, in the well, the crude oil started flowing from the reservoir. So you have to bring it back to the surface. So we need the sufficient pressure in the reservoir to get your oil or gas to flow naturally to the surface. So there is a well which produces, if the natural flow is there, which produces oil and gas without any requirement of artificial lifting. But sometimes you need the equipments to bring the oil to the surface to enhance your production apart from your natural flow. So then equipment commonly used consists of tubing, well head and exhaust tree. So you can see here the pressure gauge, master valve, grossing valve, tubing head, casing heads and to the production equipment, choke and wing valve. So you can see here the oil well, the tubings, see in the casing is there, then tubing as shown, then perforations also mentioned in the diagram. So this is the flowing well. So artificial lifting, so only it is achieved by the mechanical device inside the well. So either pump or well assist string, or by decreasing the weight of the hydrostatic column by injecting the gas or gas into the liquid from distance down the well. So why this artificial technology is used? So there are wells where there is a insufficient pressure in the reservoir to lift the produced fluids to the surface. So in such cases, we have to bring it back to the surface. So hence, we are using this artificial lift technology. So in the, there are also natural flowing wells, which there is no need of the artificial lifting technologies. But in natural flowing wells also, we have to increase the flow rate above the level which flows naturally. So this technology, artificial lifting, is used to bring oil from the reservoir to the surface because of the decreasing reservoir pressure. So what are these commonly used methods available? There are four common methods of artificial lifting, that is beam pumping, SRP, sucker rod pumping units, submersible pumping or electrical submersible pumps, gas lift, hydraulic pumping. So these are the artificial lifting methods. So artificial lifting, beam pumping, SRP. So this is designated to be inserted inside the tubings of the well and maintain the purpose to gather the fluids below the well and lift it to the surface. So what are the components? You can see in the next slide. So barrel, valves and piston. So the pump is connected to the unit, that is SRP unit, at the surface by a string of sucker rods. So it is called as sucker rod pumping. Sucker rods are there. And these sucker rods are how they are. They are stoked up and down in the tubing. So it's moving up and down. So it makes strokes and activating the pumps at the bottom. So at the surface, there is a large mechanical device called beam pumping unit is attached. So this is the your diagram of beam pumping. So number one, you can see numbered engine or motor. Number two is gear reducer. Three is your crank arm. Four is counterweight. So number five is pitman arm. Then six, walking beam. Samson post is seven. RCD is number eight. Then bridle is in the nine, number nine. Then polished rods, number 10. Stuffing box is 11. Sucker rods is 12. You can see the sucker rods where it's used to raise up and down. Then number 13 tubing, 14 is your casing and 15 is your pump. So this is a beam pumping unit or SRP. So based on the size of the pump, it produces generally 5 to 40 liters of liquid for every single stroke. So this is an emulsion of crude oil and water. So it contains some crude oil plus this emulsion, water and oil. So the pump size also determined by the depth and weight of the oil in order to remove with deeper extraction, requiring more power to move the heavier lengths of sucker rods. So what are the advantages of beam pumping? So it's having high system efficiency, then economically to repair and service, and flexibility. It means that it's adjusting the production through stroke length and speed. Then high salvage value for surface unit and downhole equipments. Then disadvantages of beam pumping. So it is limited to relatively low production volumes, that is less than 1000 barrels per day. So only limited to onshore application. So because a big surface unit is required, so it is only mostly in the onshore obligations. Then next is your ESP, that is electrical submersible pumps. So it consists of an electric motor which is attached to the pump on the end of the tubing string. So what will happen? So this electric motor helps to rotate or turns the centrifugal pump. So this pump forces the oil from the bottom of the well to go through the inside of the tubing and out at the surface. And for this pump we need electricity. So the electricity is supplied through an electric cable which is attached to the side of the tubing and connected to the electric motor. So this is the ESP. So what is the advantages of ESP? So this is a high volume and depth capacity and high efficiency over 1000 barrels per day and low maintenance and minimal surface equipments required, and it is a very high resistance to corrosive environment and uses in deviated wells and vertical wells with doglegs, that is DLS. So during the well design, so the drilling engineer, so they will calculate and design the geometry of the well and they will make the DLS according to the type of well, whether it is deviated well and vertical well. So the disadvantage is very poor ability to pump sand. So it is difficult for this pump to pump the sands. from the well. So this is the gas lift. So you can see the series of devices which are called gas lift. Valves are inserted into the sides of the tubings. And when the gas is injected into the well, you can see here, gas injection is going on through the tubing casing annulus. See, tubing casing annulus, and enters to the tubing through the gas lift mandrels. Mandrels also, gas lift mandrels and gas lift valves are there. Through that only, the injected gas is entering. And the fluids in the tubing is made lighter by the gas. As a result, the mixture is pushed to the surface by reservoir pressure. So that is your gas lifting. So you can check in the diagram, right side, it is shown here, gas lifting. So a source of gas and compression equipment is required for the gas lift, and proper installation and compatibility of gas lift equipments in the surface and the well bore are needed to any gas lift system. So what are the main advantages this gas lift? So this gas lift is an artificial lift process that closely resembles the natural flow process and basically operates as an enhancement or extension of the process. The only major requirement is an available and economical supply of pressurized gas. Supply of pressurized gas. Pressurized gas, the next one. So what are the disadvantages of gas lift? So now we have learned the advantages. Now what are the disadvantages of gas lift? So it is not visible if no source of gas is present. High initial capital purchase cost and maintenance intensive and difficult to operate. The next is your plunger lift. And this plunger lift is normally used in on low pressure gas wells with some condensate, oil or water, or high gas ratio. High gas ratio oil wells. So in such cases, what will happen? The well flow conditions can be such that the liquid starts collect the downhole and blocks the gas so that the well production stops. So in this case, the plunger lift with an open and closed valve can be inserted in the tubing. Then a plunger catcher is available at the top, which opens the valve and can hold the plunger, while another mechanism downhole will close the valve. So this is the plunger lift operation. So this is the schematic which I explained. So you can see here, lubricator, upper outlet, plunger catcher is there in the top, you can see. Then you can see the arrival sensor, lower outlet, master outlet. Then casing tubing, lifted liquid, then plunger with the closed valve is shown, then gas pushing on plunger, then bottom valve bumper and valve closer. Then motor valve with control also shown here. This is the plunger lifting schematic. Then artificial lift, hydraulic pumping. So high pressure oil is pumped into the well through the tubing string. So at the tubing string, you can see here, shown in the right hand side. So at the bottom of the well, the powered oil enters a mechanical device, causing it to reciprocate. So what will happen? This mechanical device will activate the pump, which lifts the oil from the producing formation together with the expended power oil to the surface. Therefore, this system consists of a surface power fluid system, a prime mover, a surface pump, and a downwall jet or pump. So this is your explanation of your hydraulic pumping. So you can see here, the right hand side. So this powerful fluid on the surface will actuate the engine into pump, and the power fluid returns to the surface produced oil. So what are the, so these are the 4 points of hydraulic pumping. You need description. So what are the advantages of hydraulic pump? There are no moving parts, high volume capability, and multiple production from a single package. Then low pump maintenance. And disadvantage is that it is having a very high initial capital cost and very complex to operate. It is hydraulic pumping. Then next is our, we'll come to the fourth topic, that is oil treating methods. So how you are, so you produced by all these methods from your well. So what we are going to do next? So you are to treat the produced oil. Once the oil comes out of the well, it will contains oil, water, gas, and even some sand is available, some foreign materials, water and sand, so which must be separated from the oil and gas before it should be sent to the transportation for sale. So this process is known as oil treating or oil dehydration, in which the water is removed from the oil. So we will call it as the foreign material, which present is the basic sediment and water, BSW. So the BSW content must be less than 1% before the oil will be acceptable for sale. So once you are buying, the buyer who want to buy this produced oil, they'll ask always the basic sediment and water content should be less than 1%. So the basic types of equipments used for oil treating are, so we have the separator, different type of separators, then free water, NACODES, FWK, POW, and heater treater. So this is oil treating. So let's go to the next slide. So a separator is a very big vessel. It's to separate the produced fluids from consisting of the components of oil, gas, and water. And the separator utilize the force of gravity to separate the oil and gas mixture because of the difference in their densities of the fluids. Since the oil is heavier and the gas falls to the bottom of the vessel and take off the through the fluid lines. So the lighter gas is go to the top and removed as separately as a gas for the gas sale, or separated as a gas for selling purpose. The next one, so this is the unit for first stage. This is a brief schematic of the first stage separator. Then, so what are the components of the separator? So the primary separation device or section, then secondary section, that is gravity settling section. Next is your mist extractor to remove the small liquid particles from the gas, and the gas outlets liquid settling section to remove gas, then liquid outlets. And classification of separators. So how these separators are classified? So horizontal separators, so as per the design of this separator, they are varying the in sizes. 10 auto lens in diameter and 4 to 5 feet STS up to 15 to 16 feet in diameter and 60 to 70 feet STS, manufactured with monotube and dual tube shells. Then vertical separator also there. It also vary from size, 10 to 12 inch in diameter and 4 to 5 feet STS, up to 10 to 12 feet in diameter and 15 to 20 feet STS. Then spherical separator also available in 24 or 30 inches, up to 66 to 72 inches in diameter. So let us see these three separators now. And by function, they are classified also by two phase. The gas is separated from the liquid with the gas and liquid, which is discharged separately. And three phase means the well fluid is separated into gas, oil, water, with these fluids being discharged separately. That is three phase. Oil and gas, water, three phase. So it is classified by function. Then this is your monotube horizontal separator. You can see the gravity settling section. Then gas liquid interface, liquid collection section is there. Then top, the gas is taken out. In the bottom, so the liquid is taken out. Monotube horizontal separator. Then dual tube horizontal separator. You can see the two tubes, the top and bottom. As per the gravity setting section is in the top and the bottom is liquid collection section. So you can see the dual tube horizontal, two tubes are there. So inlet diverter is also there, the mist extractor. The gas is taken out and pressure control also located in the top. Liquid control valve in the bottom, liquid collection section is in the bottom. So gas and liquid has been separated in this system of separation. So this is the vertical separator. There's oil mixture and gas and oil. So oil level control also there. Gas is separated. You can see the coalescer, impingement baffle also there. Then liquid is separated in the bottom, gas is at the top. So this is the schematic of this vertical separator. Then this is a spherical separator. So you can see the gravity settling section, then gas liquid interface also shown, inlet diverter, mist extractor. And same liquid collection section. So you can see in the bottom the instrumentation, PC, pressure controller is also there, pressure control valve. So gas is taken out and liquid is taken out separately. This is a spherical separator. Then free water knockout, FWKO, used to separate oil, water, gas. So these mixtures, what will happen? It will go through the inlet valve and then allow to slow down in the large settling chambers. So any free waters which are mixed with the oil settles to the bottom and the oil is removed through a separate line, that is an oil line, and the gas goes to the top, is extracted through a third line. So basically this FWKO, free water knockout, is almost similar to your separator. Why you are calling FWKO, free knockout water? Because it is designed to eliminate only the free waters, not the water which has been emulsified. So that is the concept of FWKO. So you can see here FWKO, the oil and gas water outlets is controlled by the level control valves are located, which prevent the vessel from draining completely and keep the gas trapped in the top of the vessel. So normally it is used for low pressure wells, and also it can be used to handle the high amount, that is large, high volumes of your fluids. Oil, water is separated. So inlet is oil, water, gas. Gas is separated in the top. So this is the FWKO. Then vertical FWKO also there, same. So it is only vertical separation. So you can see the schematic clearly. Then next is your heater treater. So also it is called emulsion treater, which is used to separate oil and water emulsions. So it is also similar to the free water knockout, but the treater has heating capability within the specified fire tubes only. So there is a specified fire tubes. So the combustion of the gas within the fire tube is used to heat the oil and water emulsion. It is not like our heat exchangers. So simply the fire tubes which are used to heat the oil water emulsion. Heater water. Next. So this heater treater. So after the as the oil and water mixture grows hotter, what will happen? The emulsion will break down and forms into clean oil and water. The water is removed from the bottom and they sent to the water disposal system. The clean oil is drawn at the center of the vessel and sent to the oil storage tanks for the sale. So if there is any natural gas in the oil water emulsion, it exits at the top of the heater treater. Then also we have the typical combination equipments. So sometimes the equipments are combined. So oil and gas, water produced as a mixture will be sent into FWKO, free water knockouts, and the remaining oil water emulsion will be leaves the free water knockout and transferred to the heater treater. And in offshore platform, what will happen? High pressure separator will be used instead of FWKO in the offshore platforms. So you can see the FWKO, free water knockouts, heater treater and storage. So you are getting the emulsion again, water, salt water disposal system is taken out. So this is a combined equipment. And this is a typical oil treating facility. So you can see here incoming production stream. So FWKO, heater treater, sales of oil tank and pipeline oil to the separate units. And from FWKO, water is taken out. Then skimming tank is there where you are getting removed the oil emulsions for reprocessing. And clean water to the injection pump, that is your surge tank. So this is the typical oil treating facility. And the gases are sent to the compressor and removed. So this is the typical oil treating facility. Then number next is your oil storage and sales and onshore. So once your oil is produced, so you have to accommodate the oil within the 2 or 3 days of production. So it may be withdrawn from the tank and it taken by the truck, tankers or lorries and through the pipelines to the refinery. Considering the BSW conditions of less than 1%. So this is a schematic, brief schematic of oil storage sales, storage and sales. So storage tanks also shown, oil storage tanks. So in the offshore platforms can sometimes be equipped with the oil storage equipments in the platform itself located in the shallow water, and the clean oil can be sold through the pipelines from the offshore platform along the sea floor to the land. So in the offshore operation, there will be FPSO that you are learning in the offshore engineering. So I have made one video also. So you can check there, offshore. So there are a lot of ships are there, FPSO, which from the floating production and surface operation through the pipeline along the seafloor to another storage platforms. So you can FPSO, floating production and surface operation. There oil will be stored and be offloaded into tankers. So FPSO is not a production unit, it is only a storage unit in the offshore. All the produced crude oil in the offshore platforms will be taken through the FPSO and then offloaded to the tankers. Then salt water disposal. So to prevent the environmental pollution, so water must be, the produced water must be re-injected into the ground, into the same rock from which it was drawn. And the water is taken from the oil process equipments and sent into the storage tanks until sufficient volume has been accumulated. So especially in the offshore operations, so the salt water from the wells can be disposed in the sea itself. So you are having different software platforms, offshore platforms, like TLP, tension leg platform, complaint towers, and different units are there. So in that operations, what are the salts you are getting from the wells will be disposed into the sea itself. But the water must be first sent through the several cleaning devices which remove the any traces of oils. Then gas treatment. So the produced natural gas consists of different components, different concentrations, waters and other impurities to meet the requirement of sales specifications and the customer requirement. So we have to get treated all the gases. So we have to recover the sulfur from H2S and carbon dioxide, etc., in order to prevent the hydrate formation. So we are doing the gas sweetening process, the most common process, also known as amine gas treating or acid gas removal. So by the absorber and regenerator, so it's a basic chemical process, chemical engineering process. So what will happen in the absorber? So in the absorption columns, the amine solution is absorbing the H2S and CO2 from the flowing sour gas to produce a sweetened gas stream. That is, you are getting the H2S free gas as a product and amine solution which in the absorbed acid gases. So the result, which is the amine, sent into the regenerators to produce a amine that is recycled to reuse in the absorber, the gas sweetening process. So in also this produce sweetened gas also goes to another process like dehydration or hydrocarbon recovery. The sulfur compounds, the flare gas, are sent to a class sulfur recovery unit. Another process, class sulfur unit. Next one. So this is a schematic of the gas sweetening process. So you can see the absorption columns. So sour gas sent to the bottom tray of the absorber, and makeup water sent to the top tray of the water, and rich amine is removed in the bottom of the column and sent again to the second absorption column and condensed, then sent in reflux drum as H2S and CO2 and produce acid gas. And the second absorption column, you can see the reboiler to maintain the temperature at the bottom of the tray, and condensate has been removed and the lean amine is recycled. So the operating temperatures ranges of this absorption column is 35 to 50 degrees centigrade, and pressure is equal to 5 to 205 atmospheric pressure of absolute pressure, and in the regenerator 115 to 126 degrees centigrade, and 1.4 to 1.7 atmospheric pressure of absolute pressure at the bottom. So this is gas sweetening. So we have completed our presentation today on artificial lifting methods. So we have successfully completed the artificial lifting methods part one. So in the next presentation, we'll go detail on the petroleum production equipments. Till then, bye. Subscribe my channel. Thank you. Salt water disposal. Gas heating. Gas sweetening process. Process flow diagram of gas sweetening.